Wells Dam is well over 500 river miles from the mouth of the Columbia River, but the salmon that travel this distance are built for the long journey, bringing excellent meat to the fishermen of central Washington.
We get a lot of people over here that think that our fish up this high up the Columbia are not very good. And what I'm going to show you here, I'm going to flay some of these out, and you're going to see actually how red and good these fish really are. So when people see this, they're going to really think something else. The meat is awesome.
Once nearly decimated, sockeye salmon now return to the Columbia in sufficient numbers to allow for sport fishing seasons. So for the past few years, Northwest anglers have been able to enjoy what many people consider to be the best eating of all the salmon species. We've had a successful morning, so now it's time to cook our catch.
This is the way we're going to cook this sockeye. We'll cook part of it one way, part another way. This is with a little bit of garlic salt and Parmesan. And with these real oily fish, that moisture stays in the fish, so you don't have to put a lot of stuff on them. But the Parmesan and the garlic salt taste really good on these sockeyes. The other batch I'm going to do with a little bit of Johnny seafood seasoning and dill and just a touch of butter over the top. One thing you want to make sure and always do with fish, especially your red-meated fishes, white-meated fishes, you know, people have a tendency of overcooking it. You don't have to cook it that long. Sear it, just cook one side like you're seeing here today. I'm cooking it with the skin down on it. It's relatively thin fish, so it's going to cook relatively quick. On medium-high heat, you're talking 6-7 minutes tops, and then get it off the grill. You want it to taste good. You want all the juices, the flavors to stay in it. Don't overcook it.
Today, we're with Bob Schmidt and Bob Loomis of Mack's Lure Company in the heart of beautiful central Washington as they fish for sockeye salmon with guide Jerrod Gibbons.
There you go. Get him, Bob. Get him. Just pop it. Double.
And then we're on the lower Columbia River near Longview, Washington for steelhead before we visit Woodland, Washington, where we'll tour the Lamiglas factory and learn how these high-quality fishing rods are made.
Hey, I'm John Posey with Lamiglas, and just wanted to show you what we do here in Woodland, Washington to make a fishing rod.
I'm Justin Wolf, and this is Angler West Television. The plan is to fish for sockeye salmon the next morning, but with a beautiful evening available, Bob Loomis and Bob Schmidt have decided to come out to test the evening bite with Jerrod Gibbons. Wells Dam creates a large back eddy that fish really stack up in, a perfect place for the Mack's Lure Cha-Cha sockeye rig.
This is going to be the hot one.
To do its thing.
Running the Double D Dodger here, a little smile blade in front of it for some extra action. Below it, we've got a sockeye rig, the Cha-Cha sockeye rig. It's got a little silver smile blade, pink body. We baited it up with a couple purple shrimp, and that should be the ticket. Looking at the engraving here to make sure we got this rigged up in the right hole. We got that in the number 3 hole right there, and that'll put it out on the port side of the boat, so we're in good shape.
What we're doing here, we're in this big back eddy where all these fish come upstream out of the fast water and getting this pool them where they rest up right before they head up over the dam. So they're just sitting in here schooling up, resting up, and we're gonna just sit here and troll through them and pick through them and see how many we can get.
There you go. Get them, Buck. Get them. Just pop it. Double.
Sound looks, we've got a good solid hit here. We might have a jack here or a real big sockeye. That's a jack.
Where do you want him at right there?
You just bring him up. Keep them out of the motor. Pull them right. Yep, we got a jack right there. Up. There we go.
Nice job, Captain.
Sockeye fishing, getting snook, why not?
Yeah, it works.
We had a double on there, and mine came off at the last second right at the boat, and Bob got his in. It's a jack. Nice little chinook.
Welcome back to the Columbia River. I'm Justin Wolf. The evening bite at Wells Dam has produced a nice little chinook and a few sockeye.
Nice sockeye right there. That is a real nice sockeye.
But the next morning, we're back out on the river for the early morning bite, which is typically the most productive time to catch sockeye. And this morning, it sure didn't take long for the bite to start.
Get him, Loomis. Get him. Reel. Got him? Okay, hold him out. There. Hold on there. Come on. Here we go.
Got it. That didn't take too long.
Heck no.
Well, there's number one in the boat. We didn't go 50 feet and hook that fish, so it should be decent fishing this morning. Nice looking sockeye headed up to Lake Asuias. Didn't quite make it.
Well, these fish are headed up to Lake Asuias, which is, fish on.
Pop it, there you go.
Lake Asuias is up in Canada, just across the border, which the Okanagan River runs out of.
Give me a little bit more. It's a nice fish. The summer fishery opens up July 1st around here, usually just the king start then. Then later on in the season, depending on dam count numbers and everything, is when they'll advise us on when the sockeye fishing opened. And it opened up probably about mid-July this year. So when the counts get good enough over the dam, knowing that we're going to have a harvestable amount, they'll open it up for us and they set the limit. Last year it was 6, this year it's 4. So just not as many fish as last year, but still a ton of fish coming. And obvious, there's plenty of fish. Okay, reel it right there. Okay, rod tip up. Nice fish. Another nice little sockeye. You know what we're doing here, we're running, 12 feet on the sides, 10 feet out the back. These fish, they're up by the surface and everything, so you don't have to go too deep with them. What we're gonna do, we're gonna change this squitter out. It's been very productive and everything, but little changes and everything that we're seeing here is, they're really liking a little silver smiley blade and everything. So we're gonna change it up to this one right here. Pretty dang similar and everything, but what we're gonna do is just put that on. We're gonna see it's probably gonna make a huge difference and go from there.
Yep.
Schmidt, how many is that for you? That's, you gotta hand that off. Here, give it to me.
That didn't take long, just barely tightening up the rod and down she went. I already got my limit of 4 this morning, so I handed off the rod to Justin there. He doesn't get to reel in his own fish too often, so kind of fun.
Small blades. We changed that up to a silver one. We had a hot pink one on there and it wasn't getting much action. We switched that up. All of a sudden we've gone a pass and we've gotten take 3 times. So obvious, little change it up. If the rod's not going up, change it up. Little silver seemed to be the trick right there. So
last year with this sockeye fishery going off and us learning a lot more about it, it was such a huge fishery that we went to a number of the local guides as well as some of the retailers were selling all of the componentry, the smile blades, and putting some of this stuff together. And we designed six sockeye lures for this specific fishery. And it went over extremely well. As you can see, that's what we've been using this morning, and they're working outstanding. So these guys obviously knew what they were doing last year, and we put together some real nice spinners.
It's summer steelhead time on the Lower Columbia River, and Kari McClellen, who's fishing with John Posey of Lamiglas and Steve Lynch of Procure, is about to land her first steelhead ever with the help of guide Brandon McGavran.
Okay, go ahead and lift. Okay, now go ahead and let a few strips of line out, about 4 or 5 feet. So we got a hatchery steelhead, hatchery summer steelhead here. Nice little, about a 6 pounder.
My first steelhead.
With steelhead like this available, it's no wonder that it's such a popular fishery. But this year's high water has made access to these fish a little more difficult than usual. But with the right tackle, techniques, and knowledge of the river, your hookups will come.
This is a kind of a plug fishery here. So we're sitting on anchor, locking our gear back and letting the fish come to us, targeting them in a specific travel route. Today we're fishing deeper, in about 45 feet of water, which is kind of not typical summer steelhead water, but the fish are running deep, the water's warm, and they're kind of not messing around this year. They're getting their way up the river a little faster than normal. So out in this deep water, they're just kind of just concentrated on traveling. So,
hey Brandon, what I brought for you is some gels today to go on your lures. Some good ones here from steelhead of the shrimp, the shrimp krill, the bloody tuna. We got a steelhead combo and a sand shrimp. But in the past, this has been one of my favorite ones for anchoring up out of here for the steelhead this time of year.
Nice.
The shrimp. So these are the two here that I recommend we try.
I like it.
A couple of plugs.
Basically, we're just gonna back bounce the lead back to about 130 feet.
Okay.
Actually go 135 feet. It's a heavy current out here in 45 feet of water, and it's a minus tide today. So gotta get the lures back at the right angle and get them all separated. So we're covering a wide path here.
Alongside of us, we noticed another boat having some great luck, and we could see that they were using Brad's lighted wigglers. So it didn't take long for Steve to pull one out.
Well, that didn't take long.
No, that didn't take long at all. I just let it out about 20 more feet. It's fighting like a wild one, though. Beautiful. Sometimes all you have to do is switch lures, and that's what it takes to catch you a fish. Things slow down. Don't be afraid to switch them up.
The adipose is gone here.
Yeah, either the seal took it or the hatchet.
Yeah. It might have been gone either way.
Yeah. Right on.
So today we're fishing with Lamiglas Kenai Quicks, 9'3" and 10.5. 9'3" in the back and 10.5 footers out the side. Spread our gear out. We're fishing in heavy current, fishing with 10 ounces of lead. So this is a ideal rod for this kind of situation and for plug fishing.
Really the importance of the rod is you want a rod that's gonna be strong enough to hold your bait down on the bottom, but you also want one that's gonna be soft enough so when a salmon comes up to bite that, or steelhead, the rod's gonna be soft, he's gonna take the bait, he's not going to feel the resistance of the rod, and hopefully you're going to hook him up. What we've done with this Kenai Quick series, actually designed for the Kenai River in Alaska, but about 2 years ago, the Columbia River guides discovered this. They're using it for spring Chinook, they're using it for summer Chinook, and for fall Chinook, as well as for summer steelhead. So it's been a very versatile rod. Works great out here in the Columbia River.
There he goes.
Up next, we'll go inside the Lamiglas factory for a tour with John Posey. While most fishing rods are made overseas, Lamiglas, an industry leader for over 60 years, continues to build rods right here in Woodland, Washington.
Hey, I'm John Posey with Lamiglas, and just wanted to show you what we do here in Woodland, Washington to make a fishing rod. It all starts right here with the material. We have some graphite, and it comes here on these rolls. We have to cut it into different patterns depending on the rod. We manufacture about 350 different fishing rods for 2011-2012. Likewise, we manufacture fishing rod blanks for custom rod builders. But the process all starts here with the cutting of the pattern. She's going to measure out the material. Each fishing rod is unique. It all has a different pattern depending on the action we want for the rod. So it's all cut out by hand. As you can see, it's cut in a pattern with a correct amount of taper that goes all the way to the tip. So you want some good power in the butt section and then a nice flexible and sensitive tip. So now what we have is a mandrel. It's just a tapered piece of steel, and this is going to form the shape of the fishing rod. So what we do next is we do what's called tacking, and she's going to take the part, and she's going to basically use a hot iron or a flat iron, and because the material has a certain amount of resin in it, all she needs to do is get some heat that's going to tack it or adhere it to the mandrel. So once the material is tacked onto the mandrel, we need to put it on one of these tables and pressure roll it so the material rolls onto the mandrel evenly. There you go. Now the material's wrapped on, the model number here, so we know exactly what we've got, and then we take it to the next step. Now this is an important step. This is where we bind the material onto the mandrel with cellophane. Basically, it's scotch tape without the adhesive. And what this does is it's going to hold the shape of the rod because we're going to now put it in the oven. Okay, well, the rods are coming out of the oven. They've been in there for a couple of hours at a certain temperature, depending on the material. This is 22 feet high. It's the largest rod building oven in the world. We're capable of building one piece parts up to 20 feet long. So after the blanks come out of the oven and the cellophane is stripped off, we sand the blanks to take off the small ridges. So what we want is a smooth blank. And sometimes on a very small diameter blank, we're gonna need to do some hand sanding. So a delicate process, very important in the construction of the rod. So once the blank has been sanded, we need to put some paint on it. And as you can see, we have a very experienced paint machine here. It's called a squeegee coat, or squeegee dip coat. And basically just, we put the paint in here. We've got a little opening here and a rubber diaphragm. He's gonna run the blank through. It's gonna coat the blank and then wipe off all the excess. So perfect color on a rod blank every time. Right here is what we call the rod side. And this is where we do all the finished fishing rods in various stages. So we'll run you through that right now. So now what we're doing is we're putting the handle and the tip top onto the rod. And what he's doing is splining the rod. In other words, finding the hard spot on the blank so that the rod does not twist in the angler's hand. Very important part. And then what we have is custom fit handles. Each one of these has to be made to fit the exact rod that we're building. Rear cork, reel seat, fore cork, winding check. And then we'll put the tip top on. That's the very top guide. And you can see over here the process of putting the cork and reel seats on. Sometimes you need a little bit of masking tape to make sure that reel seat sits firmly on the rod and is not gonna come loose. So she's gonna mark that, and then she's gonna put some glue on and make sure that that reel seat is firmly attached to the rod. So now once the handle is dry and the decals have been put onto the rod, what we're doing now is marking where the guides go. And each one of the rods has its own spec sheet that tells us what guide sizes to use and what spacing to use for the guides. And it's different on every single rod. What we're doing here now is putting the guides on. We use different types of thread depending on the rod. This happens to be a bass rod. We're using small diameter thread, smaller guides for a real lightweight rod. And so she's putting the guide on with the basic nylon thread. So this is the final step, and this is what we call our final coat. We're gonna put an epoxy coating on the logo area to protect that area, and also to firmly secure the guides onto the fishing rod. Very important step. Also makes the rod look very nice, and it's all about quality here at Lamiglas. And as you can see, there's not really any machines that do the work, but rather they assist in the building of the rods. So each one of the rods has been touched by every employee in the building before it goes from start to finish. And just to show you some of the versatility we have here at Lamiglas, we make driftboat oars. We also make surf rods, very popular name on the Northeast for striped bass and bluefish. Also salmon and steelhead rods are on another reel, bass rods on another reel. Like I said earlier, about 350 different rods for 2011-2012.
Hey, thanks for watching today's episode of Angler West TV. You know, it's only with the sponsor support that the show is made possible, so please thank them when you can. Now get out there and do some great fishing.